Welcome to Galaxy Moonbeam Night Site. We are the retro talk program for nostalgia and baby boomer stuff here on the Galaxy Nostalgia Network. I'm Smitty.
I'm Mike.
And I'm George.
And we're so happy to have you with us on this one-hour program. We've got a lot of fun topics to talk about, and we're going to get started right away. You know, here on Galaxy Moonbeam Night Site, we talk a lot about topics from the 50s, the 60s, and the 70s, and sometimes even go back to the 40s and even beyond that. But we're going to talk today about a topic really that's mostly centered in the 80s and the very early 90s, although it does have some earlier antecedents. And once in a while on our program, we'll cover some things from later years, because that is also part of the baby boomer experience. And we're going to talk about today is the great era of music videos in the 80s and 90s, the early 90s. Now, you probably, those of you remember watching your favorite music video on television. There were some great shows that used to feature the music videos, and we're going to remember that. We all have memories of that and experiences of that. And there was an earlier incantation of that. We're going to first turn to our good buddy George Halilakos, who's going to share some of the historical background on these music videos, and then we'll dive into the later years, the 80s, and how all that blossomed and the things that we remember. But let's talk a little bit about the earlier years, George, on that.
Thanks so much, Gilbert. When you look at the subject of videos, it really is an amazing trip back through time. And one of the beautiful aspects about music videos is just that you have an encapsulation from particular eras that capture the elements of pop culture. So when we talk about music videos, we're speaking specifically about short films that integrate music, usually a song, with imagery for both promotional and or artistic purposes. Well, as Gilbert noted, that while this came into prominence during the 1980s, think about MTV and Friday night videos, it turns out that the origins of the music videos go back more than 50 years. In fact, we have to go back to 1956. Tony Bennett, yes, the same Tony Bennett that has been so popular through the decades, and more recently having done a lot of duets with various stars from different eras, he is noted, at least in his own autobiography, for having helped pioneer the music video with his classic Stranger in Paradise. And this was filmed in Hyde Park, London in 1956, and then later it was featured on Dick Clark's American Bandstand. So we can go back to the mid-1950s as our point of origin. And in that same year, 1956, Elvis Presley did a wonderful rendition of Jailhouse Rock with the prison motif, which looks amazingly different and distinct because it was done in black and white, or at least rather it was shown in black and white, but it's my understanding that it was originally filmed in color, but because at that time there weren't color TVs widely available, and so the stark contrast really made it very popular. And then the third one that comes into the origins, and I think that this is one that Mike Bragg noted at one time, really helped usher in the age of music videos onto a grander scale, was Ricky Nelson, that he did Travelin' Man in 1961. And this was a video that was featured on the Ozzy and Harriet TV show, because by that time, Ricky had become a major recording star. And what this a particular video did, Traveling Man, is that it had lots of travel log scenes from all around the world, and it refers specifically to the areas that are referenced in the song. So it's really kind of fun to see that the music video, which has become such a staple in pop culture, in advertising, be it streaming on the internet or on television, really owes its origins back to the 1950s and 60s. So I'm just going to wonder if either of you have any further thoughts about the origins of music videos, and especially you, Mike Bragg, because I know that you're really plugged into the music of the 60s, and I think that Ricky Nelson's music video helped usher in the promotional concert features that started to really become well-known during that era.
Remember seeing the Hula Girls in that Traveling Man piece?
Oh, yes.
Wasn't it wonderful?
What was wonderful? It's still wonderful.
Pretty Polynesian Baby, Over the Sea.
Oh, my goodness,
I remember the night. Yeah, that was so poignant watching that, because you're watching a typical Ozzie and Harriet episode, and you know they have situation comedy, and usually Ozzie gets out of some pickle, and Harriet comes to the aid along with the boys who share great sage wisdom. And then the show's over, and they run the credits, but all now we dissolve. And there's Ricky himself up on stage, I believe, that the wavy crew cut.
Yes.
And the band, and he starts into I'm a Traveling Man. And then, okay, this is going to be good. We're going to watch Ricky Nelson do this for the next 3 minutes or so. And now they dissolve to this beautiful Polynesian paradise, Tahiti or Hawaii, with girls in grass skirts. And I was just a little kid, but I remember that as though it was last Saturday or last Thursday night. And the whole music video idea started way back, even in the 1920s. And I'll tell you how. Even in 1995, you would have flickers that would have music, usually a carousel-type music to back it up. But in the 20s, a couple of guys, one by the name of Max Fleischer, we all know who Max Fleischer was, but most of the listeners may not. He was one of the early pioneers of animated cartoons on the big screen. Well, he and his partner got together, and they came up with an interactive music video. And these were known as the bouncing ball sing-alongs. These were the music videos, and they would have a scene, usually still pictures, a video made of still shots, almost a slideshow. We would call it a slideshow nowadays, with a lyric line underneath and a bouncing white ball that would tell the audience in the movie. And they would play these before the regular feature and at the middle, at the intermission. By the sea, by the bouncing ball. Now, that was the first music interactive video. We fast forward, so to speak. We use cliches here. It's okay. We can do whatever we want.
It's our show.
Yes. So I can use cliches once in a while if I want to. I can use cliches like a man running out of a burning building, talking about my music video collection is on fire. However, getting back to the source at hand, and the subject at hand, rather, we decide that MTV opens up in 1981. Now, we talk about MTV as the first music video station. To some degree, it's true. Australia had one a few years even before that. I think it was called Sound.
Yes, it did, because I think the Seekers were on that one, Olivia Newton-John.
Absolutely, you got it, the Seekers, and if you really want to go back a few years before that, the Big Bopper produced a number of music videos, and he's the one that originally gave birth and coined the term music video. He was on a interview show, and they were asking him about some of the projects he was doing, some of the shows. He goes, we're actually producing a couple of music videos, and one with Bill Haley. He used the term music video in 1959, very shortly before his death, with Buddy Holly and Ritchie Valens. So he coined the term music video. Music video also was very prominent on the USA channel in the late 70s. But throughout the country, if your cable carrier offered the USA channel, which was very infant in its development, they had a show that played 24-hour videos. They were in rotation, and it was the early MTV. It was not even hosted.
Mike, was that the one, because you mentioned the 70s, is that the one that featured the music video song Cruel to Be Kind? I seem to recall that was done in the 70s, about 1978 or so, and I seem to recall seeing that. And it was done actually from the singer whose name escapes me at the moment. I believe his last name was Lowe, perhaps. But in any case, it was supposedly done from his wedding. That actually it was a video done, and it involved, I guess, himself and his then wife and everybody.
Yeah, you may be close to that. That sounds very familiar. Of course, the music videos, even before MTV, you had the concert films.
Yes,
and
yes.
And these were films that had music laid in under the footage, under the 16-millimeter footage, and they would cut those down into 3 or 4 minute clips and use them a lot in news and feature stories. The Beatles, actually, when we're talking about music videos or music movies or music video movies, we could go back to the mid-60s to Hard Day's Night and Help, which was a music video that lasted about an hour and a half or 2 hours long each.
And each one of those could be parceled out in song-based
yes.
segments, because from both of those films, they were filmed in the music studio.
Yes.
But then also there was concert scenes, staged, of course, and then there were also scenes in the out-of-doors.
Yes,
I mean, there's the classic one that I enjoyed from Hard Day's Night titled This Boy, and it's regarded as Ringo's theme, and it's where Ringo is walking along the river there or in the park, and he's there with another boy, and it's very, very poignant because Ringo was sort of the quiet member of the group, but you had an opportunity to see him up close with that that music video.
The Europeans did have the first market on the music video scene. With the BBC in charge, they had to keep things pretty much contained to something that was going to be allowed and not censored by the BBC. Therefore, you could not create a music video such as the ones you see today. There's no way, no how, not going to happen. But in the 60s and 70s, you could take pieces, just like you said, George, out of movies. And Hard Day's Night and Help were nothing but music segments with some dialogue around them, and pull those segments out. And those were the very first grand mainstream music videos related to entertainment on a short form.
Now, you all may have talked about this in an earlier episode, but I guess the same could be said for their television program that was released in the United Kingdom in the mid to late 60s, titled Magical Mystery Tour, which, of course, was an album of theirs during that same period. It also was essentially one long music video that could be parceled out in song-based segments in different settings. Am I correct on that remembrance?
You're certainly correct, and somebody missed the boat on that, because the big guys, the MTV people, we talked before in our shows about public access TV. There were music video shows on public access TV in the 70s. Smitty, I don't know if you recall some of them, but it was not like Wayne's World. It would be a guy that would be your host, and he had come on, and he said, we're going to go tonight to several videos that just came in. And I remember watching on public access TV, basically you could do anything you want as long as it wasn't obscene and
right.
you didn't swear. And these guys were actually doing music video shows for an hour or 2 hours on Friday night on Time Warner or Cox
wow.
Cable 23 or Time Warner 19. And I remember even in L.A. on Century, they were more interesting on Friday nights to watch because Miami Vice didn't come on till 10 o'clock, so we would watch public access TV, believe it or not. And everybody could get public access TV. Somebody missed the boat there because I thought, you know, the guy who promoted. But I think one of the songs you think of in the very early days, and this is probably one of the first popular music, was Video Killed the Radio Star. I know that song was usually the first song in all music videos. Video killed the radio star. There was probably my favorite, and this was commercial. This is long after public access TV, and Gilbert, you will know more a lot on this to comment, was Video Concert Hall.
Yeah.
If you remember those shows, they were genre shows based on the hot videos of the week. They were basically the hot songs of the week, but they were video components added, and they were basically lip sync.
What's interesting about that is that you mentioned about Australia, the Seekers, which are they're one of my favorite groups from that era. But I recall, and you can see it on YouTube, that they did in studio, I'll Never Find Another You. And it's interesting that the way in which they did it was as if they were recording it for the first time. We've discovered the song. They actually show Judith Durham sitting in the dentist's office, and they call her, and they said, hey, we have this new song. We'd like you to come in and record with us. And they show her coming into the studio, and it's shot in full color, as if it was done just very recently.
Mm-hmm.
And then they took that same concept, and they did a very beautiful rendition of the Birds song, Turn, Turn, Turn. But that was filmed outdoors in a vineyard, I believe, or in a farm, and it's very, very well done how they were able to accomplish that. And that's something that was done back in the 60s, as Mike noted, as part of this promotional concert features, and it helped to showcase the artist.
It was interesting that, you know, we're talking about that period, but then I'm also recalling that we used to see, I've seen them before, from the big band era, you would see...
Gene Krupa.
Yeah, exactly, or Cab Calloway, or Glenn Miller, or... Were those originally shorts that were aired in the movie theaters, Mike, that maybe as a little feature they'd show... It'd be a film of a band or an orchestra playing, a well-known band?
Well, they were known as filler mosaics.
Okay.
Somebody would go in with camera gear and set up at a Cab Calloway or Duke Ellington concert, and they would basically film the entire hour and a half set and then take each song out and sell those to the movie theaters or whatever. Even in Times Square, they had the very early versions of Diamond Vision. And there's some YouTube videos under the Sanka Coffee sign. You see Cab Calloway up there. And it was nothing more than, at the time, the standard, I believe, was maybe 16 millimeter.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think they had the budgets for 35 millimeter, but they were very well done, and they've been very well kept and preserved over the years. Most of them were black and white. Billie Holiday did a number of those, singing where she put her songs to video.
What about Battle of the Bands? Because I think from that same era, being a former drummer, I seem to recall, but you can only get it on audio version now. The video, I believe, has been lost. But it essentially involved Benny Goodman, who at that time, I believe, had Gene Krupa as his drummer. And he goes uptown into Harlem, and they go up against a big band led by Chick Webb, who was a very strong drummer himself at that time. And they had different versions of... of the same song. I think it was Sing, Sing, Sing.
Yeah, that sounds very familiar, that they would have the Battle of the Bands. And I guess was there some voting thing in conjunction with that, or was there some kind of a contest, or was it just...
I think it was done informally about who could get the largest applause. But I think, and they both applauded each other. They had distinctly different styles, and they were very, very good.
Yeah.
Well, hopefully we can all agree that mainstream and more contemporary and popular and big business music video became real and very prominent in American pop culture in 1981. People quickly noticed the value of having a music video. Number one, it's timeless. If you're syncing and your records aren't charting, as long as the videos were around and you got a new song, people would go to the video. Of course, you could not go search them like you can now on YouTube. But you could certainly tape them on your VHS deck, some of the more favorite ones. And moving along to big business and big music, people immediately start seeing where we're going to have to get away from just shooting film of these performers doing their songs and calling it a video. Then came the storylines and the scripting, and some of these were so high-priced, they were almost budgeted to the price of a feature film. Now, we go to 1983, and probably one of the most famous videos of all time, directed by none other than USC film alumni John Landis, was a song that was probably never going to make it on radio because the original version on the record was 14 minutes long. But it was put together, and they said, this is going to be the most prominent video. This is going to connotate the era of the 1980s hot, glossy, expensive video. And who was behind it? None other than Michael Jackson, with the help of a fellow by the name of Vincent Price, who we've talked about many times on the shows. And it was the entire video, 14-minute-long video version of Thriller. Now, how many of you out there have never seen the video of Thriller? With Michael Jackson battling the zombies. And the zombies are big in vogue now, today in 2015, but in 1983, you didn't have a whole lot of zombies, other than on Halloween, with Vincent Price doing a little voiceover narrative, the funky smell of eons dead bodies. All right, that was a production, especially with John Landis at the controls. It was going to get unruly quick, but that still remains one of the finest, most prominent videos, and it was only $800,000 to produce, but in today's money, that video would have cost probably north of $5 million.
Yeah, that was actually really almost like a little miniature motion picture in and of itself. And that's a good introduction to how music videos evolve. We're going to continue with this topic because we've got more to talk about music videos, especially our recollections of videos in the 80s. We'll continue with that in just a moment after this retro commercial, so don't go away. You're listening to Galaxy Moonbeam Nightside on the Galaxy Nostalgia Network.
Surprise party!
Add sparkle to your life
with Canada Dry.
Add flavor to your life
with Canada Dry.
The sparkling, flavorful, quality drink
made by Canada Dry.
Canada Dry adds sparkle to a party so many ways. Bright-tasting ginger ale, true fruit orange in king-size bottles, sparkling grapefruit, root beer too, all your favorite sparkling flavors. In big party-sized bottles, they make a delectable party punch or delicious ice cream sodas. And for the grown-ups, there's Canada Dry mixers. Ginger ale, club soda, quinine water.
Make life more fun
with Canada Dry.
For everyone,
there's Canada Dry.
The sparkling, flavorful, quality drink
made by Canada Dry. America's first family of beverages.
And welcome back to Galaxy Moonbeam Nightside. I'm George Halalakos, along with my good friends Gilbert Smith and Mike Bragg. We're talking about music videos, and now we're coming to the era that all of us have such fond memories of, the 1980s. Basically a golden age for music videos as it became a part and a staple of American pop culture. And I remember this time as when music videos were associated with major films from that era. The ones that come to mind are Back to the Future, Flashdance, Top Gun. What about you guys? Do you have any favorite music videos from that era that come into mind?
There are just so many of them, George, and that truly was the golden era. I remember some of the television programs. Now, of course, we had MTV, which at that time played music videos. They don't do that anymore. MTV doesn't do that. But I also remember that on Friday and Saturday nights on Superstation WTBS, there was a program called Night Tracks. That would air, I believe, they'd air for 6 hours or something. They'd repeat, the block in three-hour blocks. I forget something like that. My friends and I had kind of a little factory going. I think the statute of limitations may have passed already, so I'll share this. My father and I, just very, very briefly, my late father and I acquired a C-band satellite system in 1981 that was a big 10-foot dish. And we had a subscription to some of these channels, and I was always a stickler for quality. I wanted the best quality stuff, and sometimes the cable picture didn't really provide a very good signal. So I would record hours of these music videos, and then my friends and I would go through and we would cherry pick the videos that we liked and then edit them onto our own tapes. So I still have in my collection, I think, about probably 6 or 7 tapes of music videos from that era. But I mean, there were some great songs that we remember. Obviously, Michael Jackson, Belinda Carlisle. You've mentioned Belinda Carlisle
before. Circle in the Sand.
There were just so many artists. I can't even think of them right now. There were so many. But it was really, truly the golden era. The videos were available on MTV, on VH1. They were available on Night Tracks. I remember NBC had Friday night videos also for a while.
Yes, yes.
Just truly a golden era of that genre that had just developed into this era of music videos. And the songs were popular songs of that period, either dance tunes or, again, as you mentioned, George, affiliated with popular movies of that era.
Yes, Flashdance was one that really comes to mind. There were several segments of Flashdance that
yes.
they were able to take out for some of those wonderful songs they did. I'm also remembering, if I'm not mistaken, that they also started finally handing out awards for best music videos. There's
yes.
One, for example, that has come back into prominence because of its association with a TV commercial. The song is Take On Me, and
mm-hmm.
it's by the group called A-ha.
Yeah.
And it's the video focuses on a romance adventure story of a woman who descends into a newspaper comic strip with a mysterious stranger. While she's dining at a cafe in New York City, and then all of a sudden, when she returns to her apartment, she's able to once again return into that fantasy world. That's a real popular one. I think also Kenny Loggins did a series of videos for Top Gun, in which that movie, which talks about U.S. Navy fighter pilots, that they were able to have some terrific videos with that that also involved not only Kenny Loggins, but also the group Berlin. There was a wonderful song titled Take My Breath Away.
Right.
And, of course, as I mentioned, the movie Back to the Future, starring Michael J. Fox, in which they had some songs that were done by Huey Lewis and the News.
Yes. One of my favorite videos was by the Pet Shop Boys, and it was with Dusty Springfield. What have I done to deserve this?
Yes, I
That's
forgot
one of my
about
favorite
that.
Ones.
Wonderful
yeah.
memory.
Yes. Mike, how about you? Any particular videos that come to mind that you really liked?
I really enjoyed the videos that had the celebrity cameos in them.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm.
And that started way back, at probably as early as 83 or 84, but you could see some of your favorite actors and actresses at any given time in that era, and some of them were just amazingly cheesy. I remember a... You know, you had Danny Aiello. Remember Madonna's Papa Don't Preach, and Danny Aiello's there in his bathrobe. He's the dad, and they're telling the story as only Madonna could do it on a video. But my favorite would have to be Courtney Cox. And this was not a produced music video. It was a concert video of Bruce Springsteen dancing in the dark, and Courtney Cox was basically a little teeny bopper with these little sneakers and pedal pushers, and I remember a little knit striped sweater, and she just come teeny bopping across the stage while, you know, the boss is out there wailing on Dancing in the Dark. It was one of the mojo moments of the 80s, but I would have to say the favorite of all time, my favorite still after really, really paying attention to music videos all the years, and I still do. I prefer the old days of VH1. It was kind of a tamed-down version of MTV, trying to attract the older, more mellow audiences. But my all-time favorite would have been the video produced by Fatboy Slim with one of my favorite actors of all time, Christopher Walken. Christopher Walken started as a professional dancer anyway. So here's Walken, and it's just an amazing video. Look it up on YouTube and watch it. Christopher Walken in a nice business suit in the lobby of a swank hotel doing all his dance numbers to a real acid, glitzy rock type Fatboy Slim song that you're going to have to watch it if you don't. I probably watch it twice a year just to watch Christopher Walken with that evil look doing a dance.
Your reminiscence reminds me of a television series that ran in the early to mid-2000s titled Cold Case Files, and it took place in Philadelphia, and it involved solving murder cases that had gone decades without a solution. And one of the interesting things that they were able to do was integrate songs from a particular era where the decedent had, in fact, been killed. So you might go back to the 40s. You might have something in the 50s, 60s, all the way actually into the 21st century, these cold case files. And what they were able to do is they took original artists. In fact, there was one of my favorites that was solely involving the songs of Bruce Springsteen in the mid to late 80s that took it from that same era. And they almost created their own music videos, if you will, a montage with those songs. Another one involved Ricky Nelson as well, you know, from the early 60s. So I think that this sort of is emblematic of what I call the unofficial music videos, where prior footage is integrated with a theme song. I know that Star Trek has been particularly popular. I think some people, one of the ones that I remember at a convention some years ago, perhaps you saw this, Mike and Gilbert, the song Doctor, Doctor. And it was all dedicated to Leonard Bones McCoy, played by DeForest Kelly from the original Star Trek series.
Well, most of those better videos were comedic approaches. They had a comedy essence to them, a germination of comedy, and they would get funnier, if not slapstick, if not downright silly and absurd. And because, remember, music videos are meant to entertain. They're meant to keep you on the couch, not getting up and going out and washing down the driveway or going to 7-Eleven for a lottery ticket. That's why MTV was famous for the music, the video blocks.
Mm-hmm, right.
You'd be afraid to get up even to go to the bathroom because you didn't know which next video was going to be on because you couldn't DVR anything.
It really was the golden era of the music videos, and again, the popular tunes of that era. And unfortunately, or for whatever reason, MTV no longer does that. They now seem to have regular programs on there.
Yes.
I don't think there's any
Everything but music.
Everything but music, yeah. But they still call it MTV, so I don't know what the deal is.
But you can still capture these through streaming on the Internet.
Sure.
And I think, you know, there are two ones themes that are very popular. One, of course, is that, as we know, there's been a revived interest in The Who, the iconic rock group from the late 60s, early 70s. The rock opera Tommy has now suddenly come back into vogue, and there's some videos associated with that that were filmed back then. Elvis Presley, who has a perennially popular level that goes over several generations. He made a series of music videos, I believe, Mike. Was it back in 1968 as a way of reviving his career? He was filmed there in his black leather jacket, and he's surrounded by what appears to be a small group of friends or a very intimate audience. And those are some interesting videos as well that were shown posthumously, I believe.
He did, and he did that. And that's sort of what I mentioned about some of these guys that figure out, hey, if I tank in the ratings, maybe if I pop a video, they'll come back. And even Elvis with A Little More Understanding, that was a video that he put, and his career was on the wane. He did a number of them. Viva Las Vegas is one that comes up, Roustabout. And it was basically a trailer for the Roustabout, the Elvis movie.
Wow, that's amazing.
But it carried itself as a music video. It's timeless. You got to go watch it, especially if you just want to get a chuckle. It's almost a cliche about Elvis, but it's interesting. And just... even back to Christopher Walken, Weapon of Choice, it's an indictment on Christopher Walken, the weird dude, and he's in a suit. And there's usually storyline, very weak storyline in most of the videos. But it was a golden age, MTV. It was Channel 31 on cable in L.A. when I lived there. And that was probably one of the most tuned-in, played channels in my age group in the 80s, because that would put me in my 30s, mid-30s, late 30s, and it was eclectic. It was so interesting to see songs. And when I say see songs, I didn't make a mistake there. Instead of hearing songs, you were seeing songs. Now think about that sometime.
I remember that when I was doing so much business travel throughout the 80s and through the mid-90s, I would travel actually not only nationwide but overseas. And one of the favorite things to do was to put on the TV, wherever city you were in, and they invariably had those music video channels, and it was great because you could either, as you correctly noted, Mike, you could see it or you could listen to it.
Right.
Lots of fun and great memories.
And I remember during that time period, I was in my early 20s, and my friends and I really enjoyed watching the videos and saving the videos, and I can actually take a trip back in time by popping in one of my old videotapes and having an evening of either Night Tracks or MTV. So a lot of great memories from the golden age of music videos, and certainly we'd love to hear from you if you have any memories of that time period as well. So we hope to hear from you on that. Well, let's change the topic here as we continue on with this episode of Galaxy Moonbeam Night Site. This is the 40th anniversary of a motion picture that we all remember, kind of a scary motion picture, and we're going to look back at that time period right now. We're going to turn it back over to our buddy George Halalakos. And George, just be careful when you go in the water, will you?
Wow. Talk about a popular phrase that has resonated over the decades. Just when you thought it was safe to go back in the water. As you correctly noted, Jaws celebrates its 40th anniversary. This is a thriller film that was directed by none other than Steven Spielberg. And it featured a musical score by none other than John Williams. And, of course, we associate both of these iconic names with so many blockbuster films that go back not only into the 70s, but have continued now into the 21st century. And Jaws was an American thriller film that was based on Peter Benchley's novel of the same name. And Jaws is interesting because it's not only regarded as one of the great films of all time, but it is also regarded as the prototypical summer blockbuster, because its release has now been regarded as a watershed moment in motion picture history. Of course, as many of you know, the story revolves around a giant man-eating shark that is eating beachgoers on Amity Island, which is a fictional summer resort town, and it prompts the local police chief to hunt it with the help of a marine biologist and a professional shark hunter. So I'm talking here about film stars Roy Scheider as the police chief, Martin Brody, Richard Dreyfuss as oceanographer, Matt Hooper, and of course, who can forever forget, as shark hunter Captain Quint, Robert Shaw. And we also remember Lorraine Gary as Brody's wife, Ellen. And this was a very exciting film because it was shot on location in Martha's Vineyard, Massachusetts. But interestingly enough, it had a very troubled production history. It not only went over budget and past schedule, but believe it or not, ladies and gentlemen, they had problems with the shark, a lot of malfunctions. And it was for that reason that Spielberg made the decision to suggest the animal's presence. How did he do it? Well, they borrowed a technique that is associated with Alfred Hitchcock films, which is to give what is called a minimalist approach towards the introduction of the actual event. And so this understatement actually ended up being somewhat of an overstatement, and that's how they were able to introduce that iconic music theme. But I think one of the things that is interesting about Jaws that we don't really think about beyond the excitement is so many accomplishments and milestones are associated with this film, which has made it such a popular film, even 40 years later. Number one is that it provided the basis for the blockbuster business model that also incorporated high concept content, summer content and heavy advertising, saturation points of presence. Instead of just gradually having it released in different areas of the country, thousands of theaters, using the bestseller novel, signature music theme. But you also found, as an aside to this, that it became part of our pop culture. It actually helped revive Universal Studios. I recall when I was growing up and living in L.A., how people would want to come and see the Jaws shark themselves and get a picture with it about to be eaten by it. And, of course, it's inspired a well-known comic strip titled Sherman's Lagoon. I think Jaws has been regarded as the 20th century version of Moby Dick, or maybe what we call the 1970s beach novel version of Moby Dick. But I'd be interested from you, Mike Bragg. What do you recall being an alumnus of the USC Film School and one who has worked in this industry about how Jaws became the template for this business model that we now call the blockbuster?
It's called budget. And the trend before Jaws was you come in under budget and you release the picture in several large cities, and then you start trickling it out in small cities in the form of something called the sneak preview or one night only, and you basically milk it. And this was a time before there was DVDs, before there was a red box, before there were Netflix downloads. Your ticket sales and your income was basically a result of how many people put their posteriors in the seats of America's movie theaters. After that, then you either made your money or you didn't. Jaws went so far over budget. The money guys at the top, the suits, so to speak, the bean counters were freaking out. They needed to get their money back, so they created a blitz. Now, this is interesting for a movie that doesn't show the culprit for well over an hour and a half into the picture. We do not see the bad guy who's, you know, the little fish, Jaws himself. We don't see him, but we hear him. So today it's called viral marketing. But the oboe was the moneymaker in this movie. The oboe musical instrument. The oboe was played every time the bad guy, who you would not see for over an hour and a half into the picture, came near or became threatening. Go to the oboe. So they basically knocked it out of the park as far as ticket sales because of the magic, like you say, George, of coming out across like the Alfred Hitchcock pictures and really not seeing what happens and wondering, but every minute you're just glued to your chair and word got out. And I remember taking my fiance, who is now my lovely wife, to see Jaws, and this was at the Cinerama Dome in Hollywood, and the line, we got there an hour and a half early, because I do not like to wait in lines, but at that particular line, we went all the way around the block, all the way past the parking lot, and you got in line to wait for the third performance, not for the one that was coming up. You got in the line because you were too late already for the next performance. You might get a ticket for the third one. That's pretty good marketing. And from that moment on, the whole idea is, most pictures do go over budget, especially the big production house, the big money pictures go over budget. There's even a buffer written for the budget. It's a 10% mulligan, and they accept that. But if it goes over 20%, people start getting nervous, and nowadays the big sales are made in the home for the home viewer. So a lot of that's gone now, which unfortunately gives rise to very marginal. You've heard of B-movies. A lot of the stuff you see on Netflix now are more like F, G, H, I, J, K level movies. And because there's no money left in the big houses, the big production houses, you don't have the ability, number one, to make a big blockbuster, number two, to go over budget on that. But Jaws made it happen as far as the big, big, big epic pictures.
Amazing that Jaws was selected by the Library of Congress for preservation in the United States National Film Registry, being deemed, and I'm quoting here, culturally, historically, or aesthetically significant. And certainly those words, those adjectives describe Jaws so very well. But I think it's interesting that what you just described, Mike, because the very experience that you and Nancy had when you went to see Jaws at the movie theater is the same type of experience that a lot of us would describe that happened just 2 years later with Star Wars, and then following that with Indiana Jones, and then subsequent releases and sequels of all of those films, that it's also the experience that is going there. And I have to wonder if part of it is also just an experience factor on a personal basis, not only just the films itself, but also just the experience that people create and the lifetime of memories that goes with it.
Yeah, it just seems like it's one in the line of those epic motion pictures that comes out, as you said, Indiana Jones, Star Wars. It's just one of those pictures that just is a huge blockbuster, and everybody has something good to say about it.
And you never forget how it ends, and you never forget what happens. And it's an interesting correlation, because I remember as a little boy, my grandmother came over and babysat me and my brother so my mom and dad could go out and see an Alfred Hitchcock movie called Psycho. My dad brought my mom home after that meeting. My mother was in tears, and she was crying and almost in shock, because she was so afraid to come home, much less to ever get in the shower ever again. After watching Psycho, she was so affected by that. My little fiance, Nancy, held my arm and held me so tightly after that movie was over, so terrified and so struck with shock after watching Jaws try to eat the boat and everything else and swallow Richard Dreyfuss, that I guess she maybe thought that we may be swallowed up by a great white on the way back to the parking lot at the Cinerama Dome. I'm not sure. But to this day, 30 plus years later, she remembers how terrifying that was. And she would tell me, honey, you don't know how bad I just wanted to leave the theater, but I didn't want to waste all that money because I was trying to impress you, because we were going together. And she was trying to land a big fish, speaking of Jaws. And she did. God bless her. But there were so many. You talk about the studio guys arguing over this one, George. And there's a whole semester, there's a whole class at film school about the producers and the moguls and the Louis B. Mayers. But imagine for the producers, David Brown, who I highly respected, and Richard Zanuck. They've done some pretty good stuff. You've got to say, whether you like their style or not, A Few Good Men, Driving Miss Daisy, Sugarland Express. They get the script for Jaws from Peter Benchley's people, and they went for 2 weeks. They liked it. They liked the script, and they bought it, and they wanted to use it. But the big thing was, how are we going to convince people that a big fish could swallow a boat with people in it? That's how basic the thought was, because it was unheard of. And they never even thought about the cost involved. And they had this kid with a briefcase that kept sliding into Universal Studios acting like a employee there who never was. This kid by the name of Steven Spielberg. Ding, 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 ding. And they found the guy who could make it happen, and they were reluctant to. And they started throwing money at it, and they got hooked. In a world where big money Hollywood producers hate to write a check for any more than what they budgeted, these guys drank the flavor aid, so to speak, and threw enough money at it, and it was one of the highest grossing box office hits in history, George.
What's amazing about it is that the depiction of Jaws with the shark swimming underneath the swimmer, providing that menacing, you don't see it, the swimmer doesn't see it, but yet the shark is going to come and swallow you up, evokes a sense of horror. and at the same time a sense of voyeurism as well, that we want to see what's going to happen, but we're also, you know, at the same time frightened by it. What's interesting about it is I noted earlier that it was an attraction at Universal Studios in Los Angeles, but also it was the basis for two theme park rides at Universal Studio Parks in Florida and in Japan. And one of my favorite Jaws stories involved that on one of my many visits to Japan, that I remarked to my host that I finally got revenge on the shark, because it turned out that one of my favorite delicacies to eat while I was visiting Japan was shark fin soup. Very tasty, very filling, a wonderful meal, and I thought, this is my way to get revenge on Jaws.
Well, that's a great story, George, and certainly Jaws, one of the iconic films of that era. And we remember Jaws, and still, again, so many of the topics that we talk about, still very popular to this day that we remember.
It is. And it's interesting that it spawned several sequels, but it never matched the original. You can't beat the original.
You can't beat the original, which is so often the case. Well, George, thanks for taking us down memory lane and remembering Jaws. And we're going to continue with the last portion of our program right after this retro commercial. So don't go away. You're listening to Galaxy Moonbeam Nightside on the Galaxy Nostalgia Network.
The first thing you want to know about anything is its name. Names are important. That's how the people at your True Value Hardware store feel about its name. This is Lew Wood to emphasize that the True Value name isn't just a convenient label. It's a promise. A promise your True Value Hardware store keeps with brand name merchandise. Names you know you can trust. With the kind of problem-solving service only independent businessmen seem to offer anymore. Their success depends on serving you, not some faraway head office. And with the sensible prices only independent businessmen working together can afford to offer you. Think of what you're really looking for when you spend your hard-earned money. Then look for the store that offers it, right there on the sign over the door, your nearby True Value Hardware store. There are over 5,500 True Value Hardware stores across the country. True Value, more than just a name, it's their way of doing business.
This is the Galaxy Nostalgia Network, and the program is Galaxy Moonbeam Nightside. And I'm Gilbert Smitty Smith, along with my good buddies Mike Bragg and George Hellalakos. Let's talk about that retro commercial for just a moment. You know, here on at Galaxy Nostalgia Network, and myself personally, I think I can also speak for Mike and for George, we try to stay on top of passings when people pass, either from the world of radio, television, motion pictures. And once in a while, somebody, we just miss somebody that has left us. That commercial that you just heard right now for True Value Hardware Stores is from 1976. It was voiced by Lew Wood. Now, Lew Wood was a CBS newsman back during the 1960s. He's probably best remembered as being the news anchor on the NBC Today Show in 1975 and 76. We've had this commercial in the queue to air on our show for a while. And in doing a little bit of research on Lew Wood, I looked him up and I came to find out that he passed away almost 2 years ago on August 21st, 2013. I was totally unaware of that. And it just kind of brings to mind that sometimes we remember people from the past. I remember as a teenager watching the Today Show. I used to like to watch that show, and I remember Lew Wood. And it just is interesting sometimes that people do just slip away from our presence, and we miss them sometimes. So we remember Lew Wood. This True Value commercial aired during NBC's 50th anniversary celebration in 1976. And Mike, this commercial is what we would call in the radio business a straight read. There was no music, there was no funny business, no jingles, no shenanigans. It was a straight read for True Value Hardware Store.
And that's usually because of budget. True Value Store today would never, ever, ever let that one air. They would put some kind of shtick to it or put somebody on it that's a celebrity or even the sound of a table saw going, but a straight read, that was the meat of advertising, especially in the 50s and 60s, because remember, before it got going in the 50s and 60s, people felt when they sold things to people, especially trying to sell things to people who didn't need them, they had to be more like authoritarian, more like a newsreader.
Right, right.
And instead of being flippant or whimsical or funny or cliche-ish, they would need to be almost stern, telling you
right.
in a very droll, very mundane voice you really need to be buying this Oldsmobile because safety statistics prove that 9 people out of 10 die as a result of unsafe front bumpers. The Oldsmobile 500 bumper, and it's not your father's Oldsmobile. And stuff like that. And now it's all glitz and glamour, almost to the point of mundane boredom.
Right. It's just kind of, now you just kind of take the little cliches and the little musical jingles for granted. But this is something different from another time period.
Sure, Smitty. And also remember the straight read guys. These guys, they made their living doing straight reads.
Sure.
That's what they did. They sat in a booth, much like the booth here at Galaxy, and they read this stuff 4, 5, 6 hours a day.
Right.
And they were chain smokers, and they read off the script, a straight read off the script. They didn't take up an eraser to anything. They couldn't, or they wouldn't be working too long.
Right. Yeah.
They could suggest a change, but they seldom did. And they came in, and I remember way back, and this was long, even before I was an intern in L.A. at radio, my uncle took me to a radio station that's no longer around, KRKD, because he sang on the live music show, and they had a straight read guy there. And he was in a suit and tie, bow tie, very conservative looking. He was well-groomed. He drove a conservative car. That was his living. That was his career. And there were hundreds of people like that, men and women, across the country. David Ogilvy writes a very brilliant piece in his book, Confessions of an Ad Man, about the straight readers.
Sure.
But it's an American pop culture segment that we probably should talk about on a future show.
We probably should. It's something from the past, and we make note of it on this commercial that we just heard with Lew Wood. Well, let's turn very quickly to a celebrity passing. Those of you who are familiar with popular American culture will obviously remember the name of Stan Freberg, who was an American author, recording artist, and he was an animation voice actor, comedian, radio personality, puppeteer. Well, Stan Freberg passed away recently. He passed away on April 7th of this year, being 2015. He's remembered for his popular work, which is called St. George and the Dragonette, which was a takeoff on Dragonette. And he's also remembered in the Los Angeles area as being one of the voices on the Time for Beanie television program. And he was born in Pasadena, California. He was born there on August 7th, 1926. He basically got on a bus one day shortly after graduating high school and went over to Warner Brothers, where he applied for a job, and he got a job there, believe it or not. It was, back in those days, it was a lot easier to get to work. He was a voice actor during some of the animated clips that they would do, the animated shorts that they would do during that time period. He worked in motion pictures as well. He worked in radio and, in fact, was a replacement program for the Jack Benny Show in 1957 on CBS. And being as such, his program was one of the last network radio programs as the golden era of radio came to an end in the late 50s, early 60s. So we remember him for that. He did a lot of satirical recordings for Capitol Records, and he had a lot of funny things. We mentioned St. George and the Dragonette, but he did so many takeoffs on popular songs of the time period. Some of his collaborators were Dawes Butler and June Foray, who, of course, were radio actors and actresses, and he had a real good crew that worked with him to produce some of these funny and paradoxical little tunes that he would come up with. And we haven't played a tune on this program in quite a while, and before we end our show here, we want to share one with you that was done in 1951, and it's by Stan Freberg and his group. It's called Si Bon. So we're going to play that one for you, and then we'll come back and we'll wrap our show up. So here's Stan Freberg and Si Bon.
Yes, I want you should assist me later in this song, no? When I give you the signal, say, si bon, like that.
Si bon, like that.
Pardonnez-moi, messieurs, just say, si bon, forget it like that.
Si bon, forget it like that.
No, just say, si bon, period.
Si bon, period.
Stop the music, stop it. Repeat after me. Si?
Si.
Bon?
Bon.
Si bon?
Si bon.
It's good, yes?
It's good, yes?
It's magnifique, messieurs. Je t'embarras de meatheads. C'est si bon. Des parties n'importe. voir les sous, en j'entends des chisons.
C'est bon, c'est bon.
Too soon, messieurs, do not call me, I will call you. C'est bon. Déserdir des mondes, ne pas dire rien du tout. Mais qui est dit,
c'est bon, c'est bon.
Too soon, messieurs, I did not give you the signal. Oy vey. En voyant notre émilé ravier, les personnes des lèvres nous envient.
C'est bon, c'est bon.
Why do you not wait for the cotton-picking signal? C'est bon. Dégardir dans un ciel mon espoir m'éveiller, qui donne les frissons.
C'est bon, c'est bon.
One of these days, pow, right in the orchestra pit. C'est bon, c'est petit, c'est science. Ça va mieux comme il y a. Tellement, c'est bon. All right, messieurs, is the signal, be my guest.
C'est bon, c'est bon.
Oh, it's real, George.
C'est bon, c'est bon.
It's so good I may kill myself.
C'est bon, c'est bon.
J'ai joué que j'ai millionnaire.
C'est bon, c'est bon.
I dig
ze. C'est bon.
Motorcycle with wire wheels.
C'est bon.
Mink sweatshirts.
C'est bon.
Monogrammed.
C'est bon.
J'ai cacou, je sais, les passants de la rue.
C'est bon.
World Surplus Life Raft, non?
C'est bon.
With two pair of pedals.
C'est bon.
Autographed picture King Farouk.
C'est bon.
Je sais beaucoup yo-yos.
C'est bon.
Then I say, si bon.
That was the late Stan Freberg with Si Bon from 1951, and just one example of the fabulous work that he did back in that time period. Guys, we're almost out of time. Very quickly, any memories of Stan Freberg?
I loved him as the host of Old Time Radio, in which he succeeded the late, great Art Fleming. He did a great job in preserving the best of the past and sharing it with new generations.
Yes, he did.
Freberg was one of the finest ad men in 1950s American advertising. But however, can you imagine nowadays an ad executive actually writing a spoof of a paying client? One of my favorite bits Freberg ever did was his version of Pacific Airlines, PSA, the advertisements. And this was a paying client. Freberg turned it around and did a commercial. And he actually spoofed people's fear of flying. And the thing I remember with Freberg was, as part of the campaign, the flight attendants passed out survival kits on this plane that included security blankets, rabbit's foot, and fortune cookies that bore the slogan, "It could be worse." And that was Freberg. He just seemed like a neat guy to want to hang out with, and he's one of those people that pass away and I wish I could have had 5 minutes, because he was raised in South Pasadena, which is just right next to the neighborhood I grew up in, but the guy was just... He was an American original, because most of the stuff he did on the cuff, he worked without a safety net,
right.
And he was just brilliant in all aspects.
That's right. He was quite a talent. We lost him on April 7th of this year, so remember Stan Freberg. And that's all the time we have on our program this time around. We sure thank you for joining us. We want to remind you our email address is galaxymoonbeamnightsite@gmail.com. Our website is galaxymoonbeamnightsite.com. Don't forget our Facebook page, Galaxy Moonbeam Night Site on Facebook, and our shows are available on iTunes and Mixcloud. And until next time, I'm Smitty.
I'm Mike.
And I'm George.
And we thank you for joining us on this episode of Galaxy Moonbeam Night Site on the Galaxy Nostalgia Network. This is the Galaxy Nostalgia Network.